Somebody shout glory. Amen. What a love, what a Savior, what a God. If you got your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 23 and 33. 23 and 33. And I'm going to go to that verse in just a moment. Just hold yourself there, and I'll go there in just a moment or two. I bought a book. I'm a book man. I love books. I know everything's going digital, but I still like that thing holding your hand. But I bought a book. I paid $12 used off of Amazon. If you buy the same book brand new, it was written in 1945, took 45 to 50 to write it, published in 51. And I've been studying the book and the Bible for 1 year to bring you a series of messages. But there was one thing missing. I was having a hard time finding my introduction for the sermon. I've got the messages. They're already prepared, but I want an introduction. And God, because of you, ordained the preacher would be over in Hawaii, and they pronounce it different than that, and I'd have a tour, and I went to a place the second time I've been there, but I'll be quite honest with you, the first time it didn't hit me, but it hit me this time. And I want to illustrate the message this morning, first of all, by what I've seen, and then what I've seen by faith, seen by eye, and I'm going to see again. But when I went over there, we visited all of the island. I mean, we went everywhere, done everything you could do that I could do. And we had a wonderful time, but there's one place. There's nothing like the place. And by the way, they haven't commercialized it to the point where it's a mess. You still have people, when they go see this memorial, they absolutely are quiet. All the men took off their hats except maybe a couple people, and they weren't, I could tell, United States citizens, so they didn't have a clue. I don't know if you know this. I was told this. I hope I'm correct in saying it, that the Japanese don't even have that in their history book. Now, I was told that, and if you could correct me, that's fine, but that's what I was told. But they come flocking over, therefore they've heard about it, and they come flocking over there no more. But I went, one of my last days there, went to the USS Arizona Memorial. Now, I'm going somewhere with this. Y'all stay with me. I wanted to put a picture up how it was. If you look up here, this is how it was. I'll describe it to you if I can. It was built in the mid-1910s. It was named in the honor of our 48th state. If you know anything about the battleships, they're all named after the state. And I saw where the West Virginia went down bravely. This ship was over 608 feet. Long, a beam of 97 feet and a draft of 29 feet, 3 inches at deep load. This was 25 feet longer than the older ship. She displayed 29,158 long tons of standard. In 1940, she was sent to Pearl Harbor. In December the 7th of 1941, she was bombed. And literally when that bomb hit her, it raised her out off the ground, 8 feet, came back in. They got some of the wreckage, but most of it sunk right there with those men that died. And if any of you know it's still an active battleship. Because those men who did it for your freedom, yeah, I see a bunch of stuff going on in America that I do not like. This getting rid of patriotism, I do not like. I was appalled when the young men went to a high school and had a USS, United States flag on them and made to turn it around to celebrate another country's birthday. Ridiculous. School board made them do it and the courts upheld it. Somebody tell me something here. What they've done back in World War II and all the wars since then, those brave men fought for my freedom. Amen. And if you go on, you'll see the memorial. That's the way it looks now. That kind of boat is what I went there in. That's the way it looks now. I want you to notice something that... this is an aerial shot. And I'm going somewhere. Stay with me. That's an aerial shot. You can see distinctly the ship from the air. And I want to show you something else because this is really something. Notice that shot and notice all that stuff around that. That is oil. That ship now, after all these years, is still sending out about 2.3 quarts a day of that oil. And by the way, that oil, they say represents, the Hawaiians say it represents the tears of those that are in there. And then I want to show you something, and here's where my sermon starts coming in. I want you to see this. Every one of us this morning, if we had a bone in us of patriotism, we would salute what those men done and those men in every war has done. And you know, another forgotten war that upsets me is my age group, and that's the Vietnam veterans. I want you to know something. Those men fought just like those men fought. Poorly recognized, rebuked, but I want to tell you, they stood for something. I caught myself, and here's where I get into the message. I caught myself, and this is the title of the book that I've been studying. I caught myself lingering there. Tell you what I've done. I went in, I looked at the oil. See that man there? He's looking at the wall of all the names. That man right there wrote 4 books about the war in the Pacific. If you really want to get a book, 4 books, it's great. That guy has it there, and I got his name. And he was just lingering there. I went in there, and I tell you what, brother, I walked, and it just upset me so bad. I walked out, I was crying. I walked out, and then I walked back in, and I just lingered there. You know what I lingered there for? Because that's where my freedom come from. Hey, every one of us ought to shout glory, even though our country has problems, and it does have problems. But I want you to know something. It's the greatest country in the world. You can't live in a better place than America because of the blood that was shed to keep you free. Amen. But I want to take you to a place this morning, and that's its picture. The Bible says it's a place of the skull. Ladies and gentlemen, if you see right there distinctly 2 eyes and see the nose. By the way, it wasn't inside the gates of Jerusalem. It was without the gate. Lee Robinson preaches a message, the bus that stops at Calvary. I want to tell you, that's the place that I'm going to linger on up until Christmas or Easter, the week before Easter. I'm just going to linger here. I'm going to give you every truth that I know about that place, because even those others died for freedom, that's temporary freedom. But I want to tell you what he done at Calvary. It's permanent freedom. It's eternal freedom. It's awesome freedom. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Glory. I want to introduce the verse. Look at me. Look it with me. Luke 23:33. Are you there? Say amen. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him. And the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left hand. I want to speak on this subject. This is an interesting word that I studied, did a word study on this word. And I dug it out of Dr. Loxton's book, and I found this word. I really wasn't familiar with it, but I've done a lot of digging into it. I want to speak this morning on the place of perfidy. The place of perfidy. Some of you may have not heard that word. In the context of war, perfidy is a form of deception in which one side promises to act in good faith by raising a flag of surrender with the intention of breaking that promise once the enemy had exposed themselves. I want to tell you something. When Jesus faced Calvary, he went to a place of perfidy. He faced attrition. The rejection of this world. Everything he went through said that this world had betrayed him. Everything, the world that he created, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, was with God, and the Word was God. All things were created by him, and without him nothing is made. You are his creation. But could you imagine when he went to that place called Calvary, he went to the place of perfidy where the opposition was apparent. His own kinsmen put him there. The Romans put him there. But I know I'm not going to stop there. You put him there. I'll break the verse down. I'm not preaching on this, but to give you more substance. He said there, the place. That's what we're going to be talking about. He said, what place was it? Same place. Abraham went up on the mountain, built an altar, and was going to slay his son. God had no intention of letting Abraham do that, but he wanted Abraham to prove that he was a man of God and he would be obedient to God. But God up on that mountain, that it was said that God shall supply himself a lamb. He wasn't talking about that scene. He was talking about later on Mount Calvary. God was going to provide himself a lamb. And then the people, that's us. You. If you're here without Christ, you. If you're here and saved, you. Put him there. The punishment. They crucified him. They didn't beat him with ball bats. They didn't cut his throat. They hung him on a cross. The most defiling, filthy way to die. Any man that died on the cross, they were criminals. And then I want you to notice as I get into the message, the person, him. By the way, it's still him. What a love. What a Savior. What a God to send. It's still him. By the way, in church this morning, it ought to be all about him. It ain't about the pastor. It ain't about the deacons. It ain't about you. It ain't about the choir. We get caught up on all those things. I want to tell you what our salvation is based on is not us, on him. Amen. He's the Lord. He's the Lamb. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. It's Jesus in the morning. It's Jesus all day long. And it's Jesus when I go to bed, knowing there's a Savior looking out after me. I'll give you three truths and we'll go home. Whew. First of all, It was a place of disrepute. The word Calvary is synonymous with a criminal. When he hung there, he hung between two criminals. And I keep hearing the echo of a verse earlier in the Gospels that said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Well, the holy, sinless Son of God came out of Nazareth. But when they took him up there, they put 7-inch spikes in his hands. They planted a crown of thorns of 3 inches a thorn on his head. Ladies and gentlemen, they beat him as Isaiah said. But no one recognized him. I'm told by physicians that he was beaten and bruised more than any man. The Romans, when they whipped, they didn't pay attention to the Jews. And they whipped him. 1,080 lashes with a cat of 9 tails. Cut, going, and coming. He stood up there as a criminal. Ladies and gentlemen, he was not the criminal. You are the criminal. I was the criminal. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no one, not one. It's not him, but he became sin for us who knew no sin, that I might have the righteousness of God by him. Can I tell you, I stand justified this morning. I stand declared righteous this morning, not because I'm a good fella, not because I got good works, but because I got a gracious Savior. Whoa! Disrepute. Could you imagine the God of glory condescended, left glory, and was humiliated? And by the way, you're the one that ought to be humiliated. You're the one that had the sin. The God in his love, who's rich in love, sent his son to face that disrepute. It could have been you. It could have been you. Facing the slave block and facing death and disrepute. Ain't none of us like people to disrespect us and be angry at us. And that whole scene was about anger and disrepute. And who did he do it for? He did it for a bunch of Christ rejectors. He done it for a bunch of sinners. By the way, he died for Hitler. He died for Stalin. But before you start magnifying their sin, you were as wicked as they are. You were dead in sin. But number two, this one really gets me. In Matthew 27:39, it'll be up here, but you can make a note about it. Not only was it a place of disrepute, it was a place of derision. Look what that verse says. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads. The destination of the Christ rejectors were they. Who were they? Yes, it was the Romans. Yes, it was the Jews. But ladies and gentlemen, you're the day. A lot of us went a long time in life before we ever trusted God. And in my past life, I've done things I'm ashamed of. And you're ashamed of. And all we've done was wagged our tongues. All we'd done was give Jesus the reason. He had already died for you. You heard it as a Sunday school girl. You heard it as an adult. Derision. Whew. How would you like to face that? You up there, your family standing by, and they wag their tongues at you. How would you like that? Ain't none of us like that. Yet the Son of God, who became the Son of Man, that we that are the sons of men can become the sons of God. Did it for you. What a place. You'll find out in a few sermons, it's the place of all places. Let's go on in that verse. The unpardonable act, they that pass by. I'm going to give you something here tomorrow. I'm going to slow down a little bit because I'm going to explain some doctrine here that a lot of people got confused. The unpardonable act. There's one church that always sits up on a mountain most of the time. They believe the unpardonable act if you got married and was divorced and remarried. They teach that right in their doctrine, you cannot be saved. And that is a lie from the pits of hell. Because the woman at the well had been married 5 times and was shacking up. Yet she believed Christ. And she came with a water pot and left with a well. Woo! I'm going to tell you what the unpardonable sin is. It's not adultery. It's not drinking. It's not none of those vices we call big. It's just one thing going to send you to hell. And that's the rejection. That is you coming to church every Sunday and just pass by. You heard the message, but every Sunday's the same. You just pass by. You know what you're doing? You're rejecting God. You're blaspheming God. And one day when you do it the last time, when God's mercy has been quenched, you are bound for hell. And there'll be no turning back. And then the offensive odor. How many of y'all don't like smell offensive stuff? I don't know where I was at over there, but something smelled. I liked it, got sick. I know what it was. I was close to one of those craters. The one that in 2008 erupted. And I got to see that crater. And we were there close enough to the offensive odor. Oh, it burned. I want to tell you what. For you to reject Christ, for you to revile him and say, I don't want no part of him, when he came exclusively to die for you. It's an offensive odor. Then the utter rejection. They wagged their heads. Not good enough. When they offered Barabbas as the alternative, they said, let that criminal go and crucify Jesus. They did it with mockery. You know, there's a lot of you this morning here. You've done a lot of things out of ignorance and because you are blinded by the god of this world, the devil. And I don't think you would do what you do unless there's somebody drive you to do it. And that's no more than the devil. And the devil's in your life. The devil has your life. God have mercy. Then lastly, I'm going to finish. Place of disrepute, a place of derision. But here's what the place was. It was a place of death. John 19, 16 through 18 said, then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. And he bearing his cross went forth into a place called the place of the skull. You'll see that, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him. And two others with him, either on either side, one, and Jesus in the midst. Golgotha is synonymous with doom. The very essence of life was swallowed up. The creator of creation was crucified. A spear went in his side. I'm going to tell you a little bit about that spear. I'm winding now. You know what the Bible said? Out came water and blood. See, I believe he shed all of his blood. But if you know anything about crucifixion, what happens after all that blood is shed, doctor? Something fills up in the lungs. Water and the last part of the blood. And when that spear went into his side, it punctured his lungs. And out of his lungs went water and blood. And everybody said, that's the end. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you that was not the end. That was the beginning. Somebody, that was the beginning, was not the end. Yes, they put him in a grave and they put him there 3 days. They sealed it, had soldiers around it. But I want to tell you, up from the grave he arose. And he said, I'm he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death, hell, and the grave. Ladies and gentlemen, you're saved. Death stinger has been pulled out of it. The only thing that will hit you is that physical part of death. But I want to tell you, spiritual death will not hit a child of God, because my Savior's got the keys. Well, glory. He got the keys to the devil's house. You don't have to go to hell. You go to hell because you choose to go to hell. You go to hell because you reject Christ. You go to hell because you're here and you're saying, not for me. And then there's some of us saved. And you are really saved. But you're wagging your tail by not living where you used to live. Backslidden on God. How can you look at Calvary and live the way you're living as a Christian? I ain't saying we can't do wrong. We all can do wrong. But I'm going to tell you what, we'll get it right. We'll do it right. And then there's some here. You're saved. But you're lethargic. You know what this series is all about? It's about remembering something. Lingering. Let's linger at Calvary. Hey, it won't offend nobody for us to linger at Calvary, will it? It won't make any of us upset. If anything, it'd be a good dose of help for every one of us to go back to the place where it all started, where your sins were forgiven. It'll make it easier for you to forgive. It'll make it easy for you to remove bitterness. Oh, he first thing he said was, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Bow your heads with me.